Our scripture for today is recorded in Paul's letter to the Romans, the third chapter, beginning with verse 19. And as you see upon the screen, it's on page 1676. And it's the basis of our message for today as well, too. Paul writes, "Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world may be held accountable to God. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by observing the law. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of our sin. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There's no difference between Jew and Gentile, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his justice, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his justice at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Where then is boasting? Is it excluded? Because of what law? The law requires work. No, because of the law that requires faith. For we maintain that a person is justified by faith apart from observing the law." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus the Christ, as I shared earlier this morning, today, this Sunday, is in the church year, in the ecclesiastical year, is Reformation Sunday, as Luther, it's a remembrance of Luther placing the 95 Theses on the door at the Wittenberg Church, and started the movement called the Reformation, which ended up changing the Catholic Church as much, if not more, than what happened in the Protestant churches and so forth, because there weren't any Protestant churches that created the Protestant churches. I'll remind you as well, too, that Luther did not want to start another church. He wanted to remain a Roman Catholic. He wanted to simply reform the church. It wasn't meant to be a revolt, okay? It wasn't a revolution. It was a reformation. And so, hence the Lutheran Church of today that we're a part of. Well, I see it as an opportunity to talk about a few things, and because whether you know it or not, Martin Luther, can you guys turn me down just a tad? Martin Luther has a profound effect upon Western culture. His theology does. And oftentimes, I don't think we really think about it. We just take things for granted. But this morning, I'm hopeful that you'll walk away and that you'll see your theology being something that relates not just to church or even to your personal life alone, but it also is something that relates to our society. It relates to my personal life and my relationships and that kind of thing. So I'm gonna share with you some insights and some thoughts. I hope there are insights for you. And so I want to invite you to pull out your outline for today, if you would, if you haven't already. As you can see up on the screens, today I'm talking about the influence of Luther and his theology. Now, what's interesting is that I've worked on a number of ecumenical movements, and one of the things that I find really fascinating is that Luther's theology is really a center point for Christians, and that's true whether they're Roman Catholic or Episcopalian or whether they're Baptist or Presbyterians or non-denominational and so forth, that I know when I've worked on retreats and spiritual talks are given and so forth, that oftentimes Luther's theology is right at the center point of where Christians can come together. And so I think Luther has a lot to offer. Well, as you see on your outline, I've divided my sharing this morning into three areas. The first is the area of faith, our personal faith. What did Luther's theology speak about that? Secondly, in regards to our society, what did Luther's theology say it was in regards to our society? And then thirdly, in regards to our personal life as well, too. So I hope that this is something that can be helpful to you. I know I we had a good response at the earlier service to it. First of all, Luther had three main themes in the midst of his life and so forth, and I've listed those at the top of your outline. Those are sola scriptura, in other words, soli scripture. Secondly, sola fide, soli faith. And thirdly, sola gratia, meaning solely by grace. Okay? So what Luther is saying there is, number one issue is the scriptures. In Luther's day, let me share with you, Luther's day, the Catholic Church, which was the only church really at that time, okay, was the institution, was really not run so much by scripture as it was by traditions. Okay? By traditions. And in order for you to understand that, you need to understand that it was a very different kind of day from the perspective that the scriptures and the mass and so forth, the service, was all in Latin. You say, okay, all right, yeah, that's fine. Well, the problem was very few people knew Latin. Okay? Only the doctors, the lawyers, and the priests knew Latin. And the percentage of them within society was probably less than 5%. So the great masses, over 95% of the people, couldn't read. They were illiterate and consequently couldn't understand the Latin, okay? So they couldn't understand the scripture, nor could they understand the service. Now, I've been to services when I was in Haiti, for instance, and also in Guatemala this summer, where it was almost primarily in the native language. You know what? It was great. I enjoyed it, but I can't say that I got a lot out of it from an understanding perspective, okay? I saw a lot of faith exhibited in those services and so forth, but it wasn't as meaningful as if I knew the language, okay? Just like if you came here and you only spoke German, and I'm up here preaching in English, and you have no idea what I'm talking about, or what the scriptures are, or what we're singing about, or anything, okay? So, number one, he said, we got to get back to the scriptures, because he was a New Testament professor at a relatively new university called Wittenberg, and one of the things that he found in studying the New Testament was Paul's writing, particularly the scripture that I read to you just a few minutes ago from Romans chapter 3, okay, which talks about that our salvation comes by faith, by a faith relationship, not by our works. You see, the church was demonstrating to the world that it was by works. You'd come and see the priest would say, you know, for your sins you need to do so many Hail Marys, or you need to burn so many candles, okay? Or you need to pay an indulgence for something, okay? So it was all by works, all righty? And the orientation was toward their works. What am I doing to live a good life? Well, Luther said, hey, look at the scripture. And I printed out the one verse that was key to Luther, Romans 3:28, for we maintain that a person is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. Because the fact of the matter is, as many works as I want to do, I can't do enough to justify myself. Because I still have sins that are overpowering. Okay? And so it's a matter of having a faith relationship with Jesus that brings me salvation. That's where it comes from. And Luther brings out this idea. Well, the church didn't like it at the time for a variety of reasons, but it's true to the scripture. And so number one, he said, we got to look at the scriptures, not look at our traditions, not look at canon law, not look at all those things. Let's look at the scriptures first and foremost. So he does that, and in the process, he finds out that faith is key, and that God's mercy or God's grace is also key. Okay? So that's where those three mottos come from, sola scriptura, sola fide, sola gratia. Okay? So justification and salvation come by way of faith, a faith relationship. Secondly, one of the things that he said was that the scriptures also speak to something called the priesthood of believers. Now, under that, I've printed a portion of scripture from 1 Peter chapter 2. Okay? where Peter writes, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. And what Luther is saying there is that because it is a faith relationship, it is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, that everybody can have that. The word priest means, it comes from the Latin word pontifex, meaning bridge builder. What a priest does is that a priest is supposed to build a bridge to the people of God from God. He's the intermediary. That's why Jesus is called the high priest in Scripture, okay? Because he's built that bridge, all right? But what he's saying is it doesn't take a particular degree. You don't have to sit up front up here in order to be one of those people who do that, that everybody is intended to be a priest of Jesus Christ. In other words, you and I, all, no matter what our degree is, no matter what our background, if we believe in Jesus, we are intended to be people who extend God's grace, God's mercy to others. Now, this shook things up in the church quite a bit. Because, you see, the priest had the control, didn't they, huh? And so what Luther is saying is that, you know what? It's not intended that we have control of this. What is intended is that we share God's love and God's mercy, God's grace, with the whole world. It's free. It's not because you do certain things. It's because you have a trusting relationship with God. That's what it's all about. And so this whole theology of the priesthood of all believers was something that developed. What he was doing, he was giving power to the people. Saying, you know what? Hey, you can have a personal relationship. You don't need the priest in order to have that personal relationship. And he saw that to be rooted, again, in Scripture. Okay? So the priesthood of believers is something that is meant to enlighten as well as empower the people of God to go out and share that. Thirdly, he saw prayer to be incredibly important. Look what Luther said about prayer. To be a Christian without prayer is no more possible than to be alive without breathing. In other words, it is central to being a Christian to have a prayer life, an active prayer life. In fact, let me ask you a question. How many sacraments are in the Lutheran Church? Two. There's two sacraments in the Lutheran Church. What are they? Baptism's one. Holy Communion's the other. Okay? Holy Communion, okay? Baptism and Holy Communion, all right? But Luther seriously considered that there should be a third. How many are in the Catholic Church? How many sacraments in the Catholic Church? There's seven sacraments in the Catholic Church. And they involve baptism and communion, but also confirmation, also ordination. You know, I couldn't remember. I was going to write them down here. I'm trying to remember what they all are. Marriage is one, exactly. Extreme unction, which is last rites, okay, is another. And I want to say that forgiveness, penance, and forgiveness is another one. So, in any event, Luther said there's only two, but he seriously considered three because not only did Jesus be baptized and commanded us to go and baptize, not only did Jesus break the bread and institute the Lord's Supper, okay, but one of the things that Jesus did probably more than anything else is he prayed, didn't he, huh? And he taught us to pray. So he saw prayer to be incredibly important. That's why we have praying daily as one of our disciplines here at St. Andrew, okay, for every disciple of Jesus Christ. So, and I love, Luther's the one who originated the wordage, pray and let God worry. Pray and let God worry, okay? So Luther was very much interested in the individual's faith, okay, and growing their relationship with Jesus Christ. But Luther was also interested in the big picture of the world. He was interested in society, okay? And as you see on your outline, he was interested in citizenship. He looked at 1 Peter chapter 2, just a continuation of the segment we saw earlier, and look what he says there. He said, submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human authority, whether to the emperor as the supreme authority or to governors who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. For it is God's will that by doing good, you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish people. Live as free people. Do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Live as God's slaves. Show proper respect for everyone. Love the family of believers. Fear God. Honor the emperor. And so what he's saying is that we are citizens of two different kingdoms. One is the kingdom of God as a Christian, all right? And we have responsibilities to God and to one another in that regard. But secondly, we are also citizens of the state as well, too. So what he's saying is that we're called upon to be good citizens, both as Christians and citizens of the state. All right? So in other words, like a week and a half from now, when we have voting, we should be people who have looked at the issues, looked at the candidates, and chosen who we believe is best for the job. Okay? And that on top of that, there is a separation of church and state. The whole premise of separation of church and state, which is an issue that we talk about in our country, is one that comes from Luther and his theology. All right? He didn't want the princes telling him what his theology should be. And by the same token, he wasn't going to tell them how or demand upon them how they would govern. Okay? But he wanted to be a good citizen. And so if we extrapolate that to our place today, we're called upon to be good citizens. All right? But each of us have our own thoughts about how the nation should run, how our community should run, and so forth. And I'll tell you what, that's why, I mean, we receive, you may not know this, but we receive every year, whenever there's an election, these voting guides from all different perspectives. And they want us to put them in the bulletin to give to you. You know where they go? In the trash can. Yep, they go in the trash can. Because I believe that that's your responsibility. I'm going to encourage you to vote. I'm going to encourage you to vote in an educated way. But the perspective that you have on the way things are may be different than somebody who sits down the road from you or different from mine or whatever. It doesn't make. And you will not hear from this pulpit as long as I'm pastor me telling you who to vote for. You won't hear that, okay? Because I respect you too much. And I respect the office that I hold. That's not what I'm here for, okay? But I want you to be educated. I want to encourage you to be educated. And that's part and parcel of where Luther was coming from. And so consequently, Luther's position on separation of church and state was very important. Also, you see under this heading, public education. Public education. Let me share these words as I was researching some of Luther's positions on various things. Several of the of noted people with PhDs and so forth who know Luther well, shared this kind of information. It's sometimes forgotten, it's written, that the Reformation was as much concerned with school as it was with church and home. Appreciating the role of education in directing church and society back to the source of the Christian faith, the Reformers were committed to the schooling of the young. One of Martin Luther's first acts as a Reformer was to propose that monasteries be turned into schools. Well, one of his last was to establish a school in Eisleben, where he died in 1546. Not only Luther, but also Melanchthon, Zwingli, Bucer, Bullinger, and Calvin actively promoted Reformed education in their writings and works. Accordingly, it's no exaggeration to state that as a result of the Reformation, public education, was much altered by the end of the 16th century. The need for educational reform was urgent at the beginning of the 16th century, and at the time there existed no school system as such, and teaching was often limited to the children of wealthy merchants and city rulers. Martin Luther was at the forefront of those who realized the need for the change in education. And with characteristic zeal, he sought to effect improvements in Wittenberg and throughout Germany. Public education was not something that was a part of society's life in Luther's day, but by the end of the century, it was becoming that. That shapes, how many of us here have gone through public education, huh? Probably the great majority of us, all right? Public education is incredibly important, isn't it, huh? Incredibly important for a society. Now, many Lutheran churches have schools. That's not to say that public education isn't important. Lutherans have typically been very much advocates of excellence in education. You know that the second largest parochial school system in the world is the Lutheran system. Number one is the Roman Catholic parochial system, but number two is the Lutheran system. But we're not in it just to educate people to be Christians. We're in it for excellence of education. I know that when they started a school down in Boca where I served earlier, that was a couple years before I got there, and one of the statements that the senior pastor Ron Dingell made at the time was, if we're going to start a school, we're not going to do it so that people can flee from the public schools that are being integrated. That's not going to be the reason we do it. We're going to start it to be a good Christian school and have excellence in education and be able to share Jesus Christ. And that's been what's happened throughout the 40 years or so that that school's been going on. And as Christians, I hope that we demand in our community excellence in education. That we see that to be something that's critically important. And we may have different perspectives on how we get that excellence, but that public education is incredibly important. And we need to be supporters of good public schools here in our community. Because education is the key in so many ways, in so many developments in life. And finally, I just want to talk briefly about life, how Luther influenced and his perspectives upon life. You see, he was excommunicated from the Roman Catholic Church. Consequently, when he went back home, he said to the priests and to the nuns, especially said to the nuns who were in that part of the country, he said, you can continue to serve the Catholic Church, or you can go and continue to serve God in other ways. And one of those ways you can serve God is by being married and so forth. And so there were a number of nuns that wanted to get married. Okay? Because although Luther knew that celibacy in his day, as it is today, is a part of the priesthood and so forth, one of the things that Luther said, he said, I don't believe that everybody who wants to serve God has the gift of being able to be celibate. And so he said to the nuns as well as the priest, if you'd like to be married, you can be. And he got all the nuns married off except for one. And he ended up marrying her himself when he couldn't find a good husband for her. And he and Katie had six children. And so he saw marriage as a beautiful thing. Look at the quote that I've placed. I love this quote under that theme of marriage. Luther said, let the wife make the husband glad to come home, and let him make her sorry to see him leave. I love that quote. I think it's a great quote. And Luther saw marriage as something that was valued and key to our society and so forth. Now, he also spoke about parents because he had six kids and so forth. And look what he said in regards to parenthood. He said, parents stand in the place of God. They have the highest authority on earth. They not only exercise authority over their children in the secular government, but they proclaim the gospel to their children. I know one of the stresses, Darlene Dawson and I have been talking about education here at St. Andrew and so forth, and we've changed some things in regards to our confirmation program to make it much more experiential than intellectual. How many here went through confirmation program of some kind in their own home? Okay, a number of you did. And typically, I know when I went through it, it was very much a left brain experience, right? It was more of an intellectual exercise as much as anything. And We've attempted to make it more experiential because the kids today learn experientially, much more so. Okay, so we need to. So I've changed a lot of things about confirmation program that I used to teach and so forth. So, but one of the things I know that Darlene said to me this fall in our Sunday school classes, they're studying the Lord's Prayer. And one of the things that she said, one day she asked the kids, how many of you say grace before dinner? And half of them didn't even know what grace was. Okay? So she came back to me and said, you know what? They don't understand what grace even is, Pastor. So we've got to get back to some of the basics because these things aren't happening in their homes and so forth. So if you're a parent of young children, I want to invite you, take those things seriously. Have conversations with them. Use those opportunities at home to be able to share some insights into ways in which we can grow our relationship with God. And because Luther definitely saw parents as being really important people. That's one reason why he wrote Luther's Small Catechism, which is typically the basis of confirmation or catechism classes. Okay, it covers all the basics of the faith, things like the Lord's Prayer, the Apostles' Creed, the Ten Commandments, the sacraments, all those kinds of things, and in very plain language. He wrote it so that parents could teach their children at home. That's where it starts. It wasn't intended for confirmation classes. Luther didn't run confirmation classes. Okay, it was happening in people's homes. So mom and dad, it's important to try to share those kinds of things. And finally, under life, I want to just talk about vocation. Vocation, Luther saw as something really important. In Psalm 128, one of his favorite psalms, he says, "You'll eat the fruit of your labor. Blessings and prosperity will be yours." Listen to these words of Luther, though. He said, "The maid who sweeps her kitchen is doing the will of God just as much as the monk who prays. Not because she may sing a Christian hymn as she sweeps, but because God loves clean floors. The Christian shoemaker does his Christian duty not by putting little crosses on the shoes, but by making good shoes, because God is interested in good craftsmanship." What he's saying is that whatever our work is, we should do it to the best of our ability. And when we do that, we praise God. We worship God. And he saw our work as the using of the gifts that God has given us. Let me share two other things with you, just in conclusion here. Luther said of heaven, he spoke about heaven, and he said these words, "If you're not allowed to laugh in heaven, I don't want to go there." Which I really appreciate. Absolutely, huh? Absolutely. And Luther, as he stood, probably the most difficult time in his life, as he stood before the Diet of Worms, he concluded his presentation with these words, "I cannot and will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. Here I stand. I can do no other. So help me God. Amen." May God help each of us as we go through life, whether it's in our personal relationship with Jesus Christ, whether it's as a citizen of a nation and a citizen of God's kingdom, or whether it's in our own personal life, in our marriages, in our parenting, in our vocation, wherever we are, may we indeed reflect the kind of qualities that are talked about here. As he lifted up Scripture, as he saw faith to be the basis of a relationship with Jesus Christ, and that grace was at the heart of that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's stand and profess our faith. Good and gracious Lord, we thank and praise you for this day and for the opportunities of it, Lord. We thank and praise you for the opportunity to worship you this morning, Lord. We thank and praise you that you are the way, the truth, and the life, as we just heard, Lord. Good and gracious Lord, fill us with a sense of your grace to go from this place stronger, more in communication with you and in touch with you, Lord, and with one another. Lord, may this time be an encouragement to one another of your presence and your working in our lives. Lord, we thank and praise you for those that have have been healed in various ways this week, or who are in the process of being healed, Lord. Lord, we ask and we lift up to you wisdom in matters of healing, Lord, whether it's in ways that deal with our physiology, Lord, or whether it's in ways that deal with our thinking, or ways that deal with challenges that we face, Lord. Lord, we ask that you be with those who are in leadership positions in regards to things like Ebola, Lord, that dreadful disease. But Lord, keep us mindful that so many times, there are many other things that plague us as well in even greater ways, Lord. And that, Lord, we need to care for ourselves. We need to care for one another. Good and gracious Lord, help us to slow down and to care for one another. Gracious Lord, we ask that you be present in all the activities that take place through our congregation this week. Lord, whether it's a gathering this evening of adults who get together with the Young at Heart group, Lord, or whether it's the seniors on Tuesday and Thursday, Lord, or whether it's a youth group or a scout meeting, or it's the school, Lord, the academy that's going on, whether it's a praise group rehearsal or whether it's a choir rehearsal, Lord, be with them and allow them to have a sense of your presence and your peace. Come and fill our homes, Lord, with a sense of that presence and peace. Come and fill our workplace with that presence and peace, gracious Lord. All this and so much more we place in your hands, trusting in your love for each of us and for all your people, Lord. Help us to inhale your grace, Lord, and to exhale your love. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen.